you say that, Lord, I lift your name on high. High above my problems. High above my sickness. High above my infirmity. Listen, everybody in the house, just put your hands on it just like. Even you at home, transform your living room into a sanctuary. Everybody clap your hands. I need to feel you all the way in the back. Everybody, a little bit louder. Everybody clap. Here we go. It's what we came to do. Help us, church. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praise.
I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad you're in my life. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad you came to save.
I'm so glad you came to save.
Oh, 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 oh.
Lord, I love to sing.
You came from hell.
You came from hell. You shore.
From the earth to the cross.
From the earth to the
my death to pay. From the cross to the grave.
From the cross to the grave.
Oh, yeah. Hey, everybody put your hands. I need to hear you clap your hands. Hey, one more time. Everybody just clap your hands. The Lord this morning. We come to lift up a praise from the top. Everybody say, Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
Lord, I love to sing your praises.
Glory to God. I'm so glad you're in my life. Oh, I'm so glad you came. Can we sing that one more time? To save us.
So
let's tell the story. Come on, everybody, you came from hell.
You came from heaven to earth, to shore.
From the earth to the ground. I love it. From the cross to the grave. This morning,
Lord,
with the clapping of our hands and the stomping of our feet. Woo! Put a clap in your hand. Put a dance in your feet. Come on, everybody, let's get ready to lift him up. With every fruit of your being, with the fiber in your being, I want you to help me repeat after me. Say higher. The Lord is already in this place. You might as well jump in and grab a prayer. As we sing it unto him, our audience online, lift your voice, let me hear you say, higher. Him higher. He's bigger than your bills. He's bigger than your sickness. He's bigger than your haters. He's bigger than your problems. Bigger than every bad habit. Bigger than every negative mind. Bigger than all of your problems.
Hello everyone, Bryce Johnson here with the CCR News. Happy Palm Sunday, and let's find out what's happening here at Christ Community. Join us Wednesday, March 27th for our Resurrection Corporate Prayer right here at Christ Community starting at 7 p.m. Child care will be provided. To the ladies at Christ Community who are fearless and flawless in their 40s and 50s, it is time for your book study to finally jump off starting March 28th on Thursdays. The book study will be held via Zoom from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. This will be a time of discussion and connection. You will all be discussing those lies that have kept you in bondage and replacing it with the truth, which we all know the truth sets us free. Books can be purchased on Amazon, Half Price Bookstore, and the Christian Bookstore. Walmart even has a double pack if you'd like to go have with another sister. Reach out to LaShika Bass if you have any questions. Fellas, please join the Men of Purpose Ministry for breakfast at Awake in Addison, Texas on Saturday, March 30th at 8:30 a.m. We are looking forward to seeing you there for the food, fellowship, and fun. Also, fellas, the Men of Purpose Ministry will be doing a book study in the month of April. We will be reading a book entitled Disciples of a Godly Man. Books can be purchased on Amazon, or you can contact Chris Jordan at cjordan@ccrichardson.org for any assistance. Be on the lookout for more information coming soon, and we are looking forward to all men participating. Join us for our annual Easter extravaganza on Saturday, March 30th, starting at 1 p.m. There will be fun activities for the entire family, and we'll have arts and crafts, foods and games, and so much more. We hope to see your face in the place Saturday, March 30th at 1 p.m. On Easter Sunday, which is Sunday, March 31st, we will be having baptism. Scan the QR code to sign up today. And remember, when we give our lives to Christ by accepting Him as our Lord and Savior, our next step is to share with the world that we have made one of the greatest decisions of our lives by being baptized. It is the outer expression of our inward faith.
I will tell you that I did not necessarily grow up in a household that talked about money, that talked about finances. We didn't talk about necessarily investing, life insurance, or any of those things. I began to learn or hear about debt-free living. And I thought, oh my gosh, you know, people do this. People actually live debt-free. I decided to learn more about that and once again, take the next step. Those next steps made all the difference.
I think I've seen firsthand what the burden and stress of debt and really even poor financial management does to a family, to a person. I've seen that firsthand really my whole life. And frankly, I think I was taught more how to be broke, how to manage being broke, more so than anything. Financial literacy, I think, is critical in being able to not only pass on something for your kids financially as well as knowledge, but I think financial literacy is an important tool in being able to be a good steward for what you have. You know, I've had overdrawn bank accounts. And it wasn't until I got into a kind of a clearing financially and started learning more about managing money and being committed to the day-to-day battle against the desire to consume unhealthily. It wasn't until that I really understood what it was to try to be a better steward.
Yeah. Do you love working with children and teens? Are you excited about helping children and youth learn about Jesus? Or maybe you love children but are more administrative and would like to help with snacks or check-in. We would love to have you be a part of preparing the next generation for God's kingdom. Christ Community's Children's Ministry, Kids City Conquerors, and Youth Ministry, Young Christ Nation, would love for you to join us Sunday, April 7th, immediately after service in the lecture hall to learn more about the ministry and ways you can make a difference. This training is mandatory for our existing ministry partners. Please contact Selena Putman at sputman@ccrichardson.org or Joseph Williams at jwilliams@ccrichardson.org. Do you love praying for others? Do you spend time listening to the Lord through His Word? Are you interested in learning more about Christ Community's prayer ministry? If you answered yes to any of these questions, Christ Community's prayer ministry needs you. For more information, please contact Helen Netherly at hnetherly@ccrichardson.org. If this is your first time visiting Christ Community in person or tuning in online, we thank you so much for joining us this morning. Text GUEST to 888-522-4627 so we can get to know you more. You'll also get information about the great God we serve and more information about Christ Community. Also, don't forget to check out our weekly e-gig newsletters and follow us on social media to stay up to date with what's going on here at Christ Community. That's all I have for you this week. My name is Bryce Johnson, and I have been your CCR News host for today. I hope you all enjoy the rest of your worship experience here at Christ Community. We'll see you Wednesday for corporate prayer, Saturday for our Easter extravaganza, and Sunday for our Easter worship experience. Have a blessed week ahead.
Clap of praise this morning. Somebody worship His name this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody shout Hosanna. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Do me a favor while you're up. Hug the person or shake the hand of the person next to you. Say good to see you. Come on, share some love. If you're at home in the chat or wherever, put something in the chat to make someone's day. You never know. You never know what saying something or hugging somebody or sharing love could bring. Good morning, Christ Community. Is everybody doing okay today? It's good to see you guys. What an exciting day. It's Palm Sunday. So if you got your palms, come on, just wave them. Wave them, wave them, wave them, wave them. and we'll explain why we're waving. If you don't have a palm, just wave your hand. How about that? Wave your hand, right? So this is a wonderful day because for those that need the refresher, right, Jesus made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, right? He rode a donkey into Jerusalem, and it was symbolic of the prophecy once again being unfolded. Could you imagine a parade of people cheering on our Lord and Savior, and then some people saying, ah, I have an evil plan for you? But our God, the victory was won. It was won, and this is just another sign of his greatness. So today, we are going to celebrate him and honor him. So at any moment, if there's an amen moment, if God has been good to you, let's wave those palms. We too get to participate this year in Palm Sunday. Amen. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to start. But you wave those branches, as those leaves, as long as you want to. Hallelujah. 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 Let's pray. God, you are sovereign. And we are waving our palm branches, God, as a sign of your sovereignty, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We thank you for enduring that pain on the cross. But, Lord, we celebrate the fact that your plan was greater. God, we thank you for the greater works, God, that you continue to do. We thank you for sending your son to put on skin for us, Lord, for all the sacrifices that were made before we even knew what a sacrifice was, Lord. So we're in your house today to express our love, our appreciation, and our gratitude to you for being so awesome. You're awesome, Lord. And we stand still and in awe of everything that you do, Lord. So, Lord, have your way in this service. It's not about us, Lord. It is truly about you. So somebody that may be lost or is not saved, Lord, we pray that you would save them in the name of Jesus, Lord. Somebody who is stuck and heart is callous, Lord, we ask that you would soften up the soil of their heart, Lord, and penetrate and saturate us, Lord, so that we may do what you have called us to do in the name of Jesus, God. We love you and praise you. Have your way today. Let everybody say amen. Come on again, say amen. Come on again, say Hosanna. Come, somebody say, Lord, I really love you. Lord, I really love you. Lord, I really love you. Lord, I really praise you. He is so awesome. So this morning, we're going to teach you a new song. I'm going to sing it twice, and then I want you to get involved with it, and then we're going to sing it together. We're going to sing it with our branches, and we're going to sing it with our voices. Amen. Listen to me. I really love you. Because you first love me. I really love you. Yes, I do. I'll do it again. I really love you. Because you first love me. I really love you. Yes, I do. Let's try. I really love you. There you go. Let me hear you. Come on.
I really love you.
Because you first love me.
I really love you.
Let's do it again. I really love you.
I really love you.
Come on, tell it to him. Why?
Because you first love me.
I really love you.
Yes, I
let's go to the next section. How can you love me, knowing all the things I've done? And then you've showed me when you gave your only son. I really love you. I really love you, yes I do. How
can you love me,
knowing
all the things I've done?
And then you showed me
when you gave your only son. I really love you.
I really love you. Let's do it again.
Yes,
how can you love me?
How can you love me,
knowing
all?
Show me when you gave your only
son.
back to the top. Pray you got it. I really love, I really love. I hear you. Come on at home. I really love you. Because you first
love me.
I thank you for that, Lord. I really love you. Let's do it again. I really love you. Come on, sing it to the Father this morning. I really love you. Because he's so good. Because you first. I really love you. How can you love me?
How can you love me?
Knowing
all the things I've done.
And then you showed me when you came. About that. He loves you, he loves you, he loves you, he loves you. How can you love me now?
How can you love me?
Knowing
all the things I've done.
And then you showed me when you gave it all inside.
I really love you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's take a little higher. I do, I love you.
I really love you. Yes, I do.
How can you love me?
How can you love me?
Knowing
all the things I've done.
And then you show me.
And then you show me. When you gave your only son, I really love you. I really love you.
Yes, I do. With a loud voice, you know it. Come on, join in.
I pray.
Church, somebody thank him for loving us first. Thank him for loving us first. We love you, God. We thank you for loving us first, God. Your ultimate sacrifice. Let's try it again.
I really love you. I really love you.
Because you first.
Let's try something different. Repeat after me. Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Hosanna. I really love you. I really love you.
Yes, I do.
Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Bright and clear. The disciplines and Jesus were staying quite near. In Jerusalem, it was nearly Passover day, and soon they would all be heading that way. When they saw who it was, their shouts did ring out.
Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed be the name!
Is hallelujah. Is there a hallelujah in the house this morning? Just grateful to the Lord for all that he's done. And this song is just very simple. It says, my response is. So if you love him, you should know what your response is. Come on, let's just lift our hands to our Father. Oh, we bless your name. We give you praise, oh God. Nobody like you, Lord. We honor you, oh God. Yes, God. Sponsor! your name, God.
Hallelujah.
My response is, oh, we bless your name.
Hallelujah.
You're my,
Redeemer.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on and give him your response. Come on and lift up your response to him right now. Oh, how we bless your name, Jesus. What a mighty God you are. What an awesome God you are. What a loving God you are. And we worship you. We say, Hosanna, blessed be. Oh, the name of the Lord. Come on and just begin to give him a hand clap of praise. Just begin to give him a hand clap of praise. Thanking him for who he is. Thanking him for what he's done. Thanking him in advance for what he's going to do. You're my Redeemer. Hallelujah. My response is hallelujah. You're my. Oh, hallelujah. My response is, we bless your name, God. Nobody like our God. Oh, hallelujah. Come on and keep responding to your God.
My Redeemer. Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Just right where you are, would you just worship the Lord? The Lord has stopped by today.
Just worship the Lord and just give thanks. Give thanks for this week that we celebrate what our faith is all about. We don't celebrate a good man and he was that. We don't just celebrate a wise sage and he was that. We celebrate a risen Savior and he's all that. I can hear the old folks say, the Lord is in this place. He surely is my healer. He's my way maker. Anybody know he's a mind regulator? I swear he's a mind regulator. But y'all, today he's a redeemer.
Bless your name. do what he did for us. Nobody can do what he's done for us. So we bless your name, Jesus. We bless your name, Jesus. With our hearts lifted, God, and our hands raised, we give you glory. We give you glory. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for being our Redeemer. Thank you for being our Savior.
Father, we thank you in this place. We thank you that you are many, many things. But our response today is hallelujah. And we thank you for being our Redeemer. And we thank you for stopping by and visiting us on this Palm Sunday. And so have your way this day in this service. Have your way in this place. Lord, let us leave here not the same people, but let us leave here touched by your anointing. Let us leave here knowing that we've encountered the risen Savior. We'll give you the praise for the impact you have hereafter. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Come on, give God your best hand clap of praise. Turn to two people and tell them he is a redeemer. He's a redeemer. He's a redeemer. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Good morning to everyone. Keep getting something in my eye. Y'all forgive me. I got a little speck of dust keep getting in my eye. Y'all pray for me. But when you know him as redeemer, sometimes you just can't hold back, huh? Hallelujah. Let me say a couple of things and then jump on into this word today. First, I want to thank all of you that were able and those even that wanted to come on this past Thursday to share with us at Southern Bible Institute and College and for our Culture and Conversation Conference. And I want to know I really appreciate it coming all the way down from the northern part of the city into the southern sector. I know you had to catch a plane on Southwest. But you did it anyhow. But I'm forever grateful, and I thank you so much for it. Also, too, I just want to remind us that this is Passion Week, a Holy Week that we celebrate. Palm Sunday is the inauguration of the week as we commemorate our Lord's last days before his death. And I pray that it will be something that is moving, spiritual, and life-changing for you. For all of us. And so I want to encourage us with that same spirit to come share with us in our corporate prayer. We have a tremendous prayer service prepared that helps us to engage the meaning of Passion Week. And so I want you to pause in whatever plans you might have, if you can, if you're working, I understand, but even that boss needs to take a chill pill. And come on out to Christ Community and let us pray together as a community as we celebrate that Wednesday night. Also, too, I want to point you to our YouTube channel this week as well. A number of ministers and leaders have put together what is called the 14 Stations of the Cross. If you ever go to Jerusalem, there are 14 physical stations that the church has engaged for centuries regarding the stopping places on Jesus's journey on what is called the Via Dolorosa, which means the way of the cross or the way of the road of the cross in which he would die. And so these 14 stations, there'll be 14 videos, they kind of engage us and invite us to enter into that experience. I want to encourage you to do that and make that a part of your devotional time with God and your prayer time. And then if you haven't, I need you to download the notes for today, for today's word. And what I've put in there is the timeline for Passion Week. This kicks off what is called Palm Sunday, or the triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And of course, you will enter on Sunday, the celebration, but by Friday, they hollering, crucify him. We'll talk about that, amen. So I want to encourage you to read those scriptures each day of the week. Monday, he curses the fig tree, cleanses the temple. Tuesday, he has the debates with the religious leadership. Wednesday is a day of rest. Some believe that's the day in which Judas betrays Jesus. Thursday is a full day in which he is eventually arrested. Obviously, the Passover, but he's arrested, and that begins the trials. There's six trials, three religious, three secular, that takes place Thursday and Friday. And he's crucified on Friday. Borrowed the tomb for a couple of days. He just borrowed it. That's what the old Baptist preacher would say. I'm just going to borrow it. I'm going to give it back to you. And then early on a Sunday morning, he got up with all power. And we will celebrate Easter Sunday. I want to encourage you too as well, if you have trusted Christ, you have gone through the steps and you have not been baptized. In the early church, saints that had trusted Christ were baptized on Easter Sunday. I can't think of a better Sunday to be baptized than this coming Sunday. So I want to encourage you. Some of you may be confused. Maybe as a kid you were baptized. You didn't quite understand it. Now you understand what God is doing. You can talk to somebody and get some wisdom and guidance as what you should do. Some of our members do get rebaptized. Nothing wrong with that. Doesn't make you less saved or more saved than the next person. It just simply says you love your Savior. Amen. So I want to encourage you on all those fronts. Let me get into this text for this morning. Meditation text comes from John chapter 12, verse 13. And here's what it says here. They took the palm branches. There it is right there. And went out to meet him shouting, Hosanna, which means save now. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. And then our main text for this Palm Sunday message will come from Luke 19, verses 28 through 40. And here's what it says. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And as he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called Mount Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it, say, the Lord needs it. And those who were sent ahead of went and found it just as he told them. And as they were untying the colt, the owners asked them, why are you untying the colt? And they replied, the Lord needs it. And they brought it to Jesus and threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. And he went along. People spread the cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, rebuke your disciples. And I tell you, Jesus replied, if they keep quiet, the rocks will cry out. Tell your neighbor, I ain't gonna let a rock outpraise my God. He ain't gonna outpraise me. I wish I had time to cover everything in this passage, but I don't. But I want to hit the main idea here, and I want to talk about an unusual victory parade. An unusual victory parade. I want to use a quote from Frederick Douglass. We were at the conference Thursday, and Alan Parr closed with the quote I'm going to use. I'm like, I had planned to use that. You trying to kill my thunder, man. So if you were at the conference, you're going to see it again. But if you weren't, you should know this quote. But Frederick Douglass, that great orator and voice for liberation during the Civil War era, has a quote that comes from his book, The Narrative Life of Frederick Douglass. And here's how it reads. For between the Christianity of this land and the Christianity of Christ, I recognize the widest possible difference. So wide that to receive one as good, pure, and holy is of necessity to reject the other as bad, corrupt, and wicked. To be the friend of one is of necessity to be the enemy of the other. I love the pure, peaceable, and impartial Christianity of Christ. I therefore hate the corrupt, slave-holding, women-whipping, cradle-plundering, partial, hypocritical Christianity of this, 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 I love the pure, peaceable, and impartial Christianity of Christ. It's pure. It's peaceable. That is, the Christianity of Christ, it doesn't divide people, it brings people together. It's impartial. It doesn't judge or discern whether a person is in and out based on the color of their skin. Or based on what they've done in the past or even what they plan to do in the future. But it is a Christianity and a gospel that is broad and wide and accepts all. Pure, peaceful, peaceable, and impartial. If there's one message I would want us to get today about Palm Sunday, this is it. Palm Sunday is a reminder to all of us who follow Jesus as Savior that the faith, the Christianity we practice is one that is pure, peaceable, and impartial. And that's what Jesus is trying to communicate here when he comes into Jerusalem in this unusual victory parade. And I call it unusual because they're waving palm branches. Tell your neighbor, we're not trying to go to Hawaii, amen. The palm branches were a symbol of peace. And there's a word there that Jesus is saying here that I'm a savior, not a warrior. I'm a Christ, not a conqueror. I've come to bring peace and not the sword. And I need to park here for just a minute. I know that's not popular, but Jesus' followers, at least they had palm branches in their hands. They didn't have AK-47s, and they weren't trying to march for Second Amendment rights to bear arms with the Bible in one hand and a rifle in the other. Because I think the word says when Jesus stood before Pilate, he says, my kingdom is not of this world. Zechariah may have been more potent when he said, not by might, not by power, but by his spirit, thus saith the Lord. Oh, the Romans lived by this mantra, Pax Romana, which means the peace of Rome. And Rome believed, y'all, that they were chosen, the chosen instrument of the gods, plural, to bring peace in the world. Except when they brought peace, they brought it with force. They brought it with domination. They brought it with the sword. They brought it with tanks and bombs. And Jesus here, when he comes into Jerusalem, he doesn't come riding in a white horse. The text says he comes riding on a colt. Depending on which gospel writer you read, some have him on a colt, some have him on a donkey. It's not a conflict. Very quickly, I don't have time to spend a lot of time here, but you got to understand the gospel are simply four writers giving you four different perspectives.
It's like four preachers preaching the same passage. Each preacher will deal with the truth of the text, that which is similar, but based on the audience that they are preaching to, it may take a different trajectory from the other. That's how the Gospels are putting together. And so it's quite possible that when Jesus comes into Jerusalem, there's a colt and a donkey. We think of a donkey as a butt of a bad joke, but a donkey was a symbol of peace. It was an animal of humility, and a colt was a symbol of peace. Jesus is making a bold statement in which the writers quote Zechariah 9:9, that when your king comes, he's not coming on a horse. He's not coming with military power. He's not coming with militarism and domination. No, he comes with peace. He comes with compassion. He comes with the gospel. He comes with the grace. His bullets are not righteousness. No, his bullets are mercy. Oh, I'm trying to preach this. I'm trying to tell you there's a Christianity out there that knows nothing of the Jesus of this Bible. When Jesus came, he didn't come to conquer the world with the rifle and the sword. He came to conquer with the cross. That's the way he calls us to follow him. That's why I say this is an unusual parade. Because, you know, in most parades, when you come to a parade, you celebrate the victory you've already won. Jesus ain't been to the cross yet. But he rides in victory. Y'all know you've been to a parade. You celebrate Juneteenth, you celebrate the victory of getting out of slavery, something that happened in the past. If you celebrate a championship by the Mavericks or the Cowboys, you're celebrating the win of the past. That's not what happened in the text here. When Jesus rides in, he hasn't been to the cross. He hasn't been crucified. He hasn't been laid in the tomb. He hasn't risen from the dead. Because every now and then to follow Jesus means I got to trust him before the victory. I ain't trying to bother anybody today, but it's easy to bless God after he's given you the victory. It's easy to bless God when he's given you the blessing, when he's fixed your family, healed your body. Worship's not a problem. But the question is, can you bless him before the victory? Can you bless him with a cross in your path? And Jesus lets us know, baby, you got the victory even before you get there. I'm trying to tell you, it's an unusual victory parade. And what I love about this passage, because I've been to the Mount of Olives, that Mount of Olives, it's a beautiful view. You can see the Mosque of Omar sitting on top of the Temple Mount. You can see the Kidron Valley, in which when they would sacrifice the sacrifices from the temple, the blood would run through the Kidron Valley. Jesus had to be looking at the Eastern Wall, which was the Golden Gate. The same gate when he comes back, he's going to go through that same gate. One of the Ottoman Empire kings of the 18th century has cemented that wall, thinking that Jesus ain't coming back. But I want him to know, he don't know what kind of power that my God has. If he can get up from an empty grave, then surely he can tear down a brick wall. But as he looked over that Kidron Valley and over to the right where he saw the Garden of Gethsemane, where he would pray before he would be arrested. On the other side of the city was the Western Wall. And he could see the place they would crucify him on that Western Wall. I can only imagine that he could see where he would be crucified between two thieves. And what I love about this text is he kept on going. Oh, I know you holding all that. I don't know about you. I don't say, Lord, maybe we need to go another way. maybe there's an alternative route than this. But he can see the place that they were going to crucify him. And yet he rides on into Jerusalem. Which leads me to my thesis statement this morning. And here it is. Stay with the plan. Even though sometimes the path may not look too pretty. Stay with the plan, church. Stay with it. And I wish I can tell you that things in terms of our nation, the church, our different ideologies, our ethnic differences, I'd love to believe that they're going to get better. But the way that this thing is going, I don't know if it's going to get better. And the temptation is to pick up a Jesus that's not represented in the gospel. It's to leave the Jesus that saved you for a Jesus that doesn't exist. And my word to you this morning is stay with the plan. Stay with the plan even when the path is not too pretty. Stay with the plan. Celebrate him anyhow. The old folk used to say if I had 10,000 tongues, wouldn't be enough to celebrate him. But if you got one tongue, stay with the plan and bless him on the way anyway. Because if you stay with the plan and stay on the path, does anybody know there's a resurrection on the other side? Let me get out of your way and tell me, well, how do we do this? How do we get through this unusual victory parade? Number one, here it is, the first one. It's most important. Make sure you let Jesus be Jesus. Text says in verse 36, they spread their cloaks on the road. If you look at John 12, they were waving palm branches. The logical question that I think each gospel writer raises the question, how can this crowd go from celebrating and shouting Jesus on Sunday and then holler, crucify him on Friday? Because y'all, they wanted a warrior Jesus. They wanted a Jesus to punish their enemies. They're under Roman occupation. They wanted a Jesus that was not going the way of the cross. They wanted a different Jesus. And my word to you is you got to let Jesus be Jesus. And sometimes he's not going to go the way that we want. Can I say it like I want to? Let Jesus handle your enemies. Why are you saying that now, Pastor? Because I think the enemy is going to get really busy here pretty soon. And you're going to be tempted in ways you ain't never been tempted before. You're going to be tempted to say a few colorful metaphors that you have stopped using since you got saved. And I'm saying you got to fight it. You got to stay on the path. You got to trust the one that saved you. Let Jesus handle your enemies. Be careful of this American vision or version of Jesus that demonizes and dominates our enemies. Because I've learned a long time ago, the folk I don't like, God loves evermore. You better hear me. Just because you don't like them doesn't mean that God gonna stop loving them. I'm trying to help somebody today. The very people we praying against, we asking God to deal with, God said, I'll bless them to let you know that the gospel of Jesus Christ is not just for the select and the privileged, but this is a gospel for everybody. In the words of the late Dr. Manuel Scott, a gospel that's not for everybody is a gospel that's not for anybody. Jesus loves the very folk I don't like. Let me just say this. American Christianity has a bad history of calling folk the Antichrist that they don't like. Just check their history. When they say the devil is busy, usually they got somebody in mind. I keep telling y'all, when we get to heaven, the devil gonna say, y'all done blame me for a whole lot of stuff. You did all that stuff on your own. And that's what we do in American Christianity. We blame everybody on the devil. We call everybody we don't like the Antichrist. Hitler was the Antichrist. John F. Kennedy was the Antichrist. Protestants called the Pope the Antichrist. In the 80s, it was the Russians. Bill Gates was the Antichrist. Obama was the Antichrist. And if you are a Washington Commander fan, Jerry Jones is the Antichrist. Give them time. They're going to say Beyonce is the Antichrist because she's singing country music now. Taylor Swift is the Antichrist. Whoever we don't like, we try to make them the Antichrist. And I want you to know God loves our enemies too, y'all. And I'll be the first one to say, I don't believe God is saying that you got to roll over and let folk treat you any kind of way. But more than anything, it teaches us we got to stay open. We got to stay prayed up. Now, you may have to feed some folk with a super long handle spoon. I mean, and don't get no 2 foot long handle spoon. Get you a 25 footer, okay? And say, baby, I love you this way in the name of Jesus, all right? But you better hear me. God loves our enemies. And it's a struggle sometimes. But I believe in those moments, we got to pray. And we got to trust God. And we got to let God handle our enemies. It's like that preacher I heard years ago. He said he had one of his preachers, and a woman was hitting on him. And he was married. And he couldn't get the woman to stop hitting on him. And the preacher finally told him, he said, man, just tell your wife to handle it. Any sisters in the house know how to handle a sister that's messing with your husband? And it dawned on me in that moment, if a sister know how to deal with somebody messing with her husband, does anybody know Jesus know how to handle your enemies? Let me move on. Number two, let Jesus change you. Palm Sunday is a word about a Savior who came into our life, y'all, to transform us. Surely he came to save us. But he also came to transform us. And each gospel records this Palm Sunday event, the entire Passion Week, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all record the Passion Week. What is interesting about each one, along with Luke, the one we just read, is that they all record either a deliverance experience or a salvation experience. Every time. They record a deliverance or a salvation. Matthew records, before he enters the city, he records Jesus healing two blind men. The Bible says that when he heals them, they turn around and follow him. Mark records that before Jesus enters into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, he heals a man by the name of blind Bartimaeus. And after he heals Bartimaeus, Bartimaeus picks up his stuff and he starts to follow Jesus. Luke here has him healing a tax collector, a chief tax collector called Zacchaeus. John has Jesus raising a disciple from the dead by the name of Lazarus. And his sister Mary was so appreciative of the deliverance. The Bible says she took a bottle of expensive perfume and poured it out on Jesus. And the common denominator or the common thread of each moment of deliverance or salvation is that each person was changed. So Palm Sunday is a word, y'all. Make sure you allow Jesus to change your life. Can I say it like I want to? If you walk with Jesus long enough, you just can't stay the same way. Oh, no, you can't. You can't. Old folk used to say, I looked at my hands. They were new. I looked at my feet, and they were too. And I didn't understand what they were talking about, but what they were saying is when they met Jesus, I don't handle people the same way I used to handle them. I don't walk the same way I used to walk. I don't go to certain places that I used to go to because Jesus has come into my life and turned my life around. Anybody ever been delivered? Anybody ever been saved? If he's done all that for us, we ought to let him change our lives. And so how does he do that? A couple things very quickly from these deliverance episodes. Number one, it starts with awareness. Awareness. That is, it is an awareness of who God is and an awareness of how desperately we need him. Give me a few minutes, y'all. It's an awareness of who God really is and how desperately we need him. That's what we see in Matthew and Mark when he heals the two blind men and blind Bartimaeus. The eyesight is about spiritual awareness. And they see Jesus for who he is. It is an allusion to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah had been going to church his whole life until he lost his friend Uzziah. And then he went to church after he lost his friend. And the Bible says that he saw the Lord high and lifted up. He had never seen him like that before. He saw God in his greatness and his holiness. But then he also saw his sinfulness. He said, I'm a man of unclean lips. And he realized, and I dwell around unclean people, exactly. And I realized for the first time how desperately I need God. So my word is to us on this is that, listen, we can't ever get to the place to think that somehow we don't need him. That's what the gospel is. Christ died for our sins and rose from the dead. The late Tim Keller, he was right on this. He said the reason why people are turning from Christianity is not because we've done things bad, but because Christianity offends us. Christianity says something wrong with us and something needs to be done about it. See, the Muslim believes if I do enough good things, it'll outweigh my bad. And when I stand before Allah, maybe he'll accept me because I've done more good than I've done bad. Judaism says the same thing. I'll do more good things, and hopefully my good things will outweigh my bad. So that when I stand before Yahweh, he'll forgive me because my good outweigh my bad. The question is, how do you know you've done enough good? And how do you know it's more than the bad? Jesus and Christianity says, no matter how much good you do, no matter how much bad you do, it's all bad. But the good news of the gospel is that Jesus made up for where we fell short. And when I put my faith in the one who can do all good, God accepts me as if I am him doing the good. And so we got to remember that we always fall short. And that when we mess up, we still got to confess. And when we confess our sins, he's what? He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you know what the cleansing is? It means he's committed to doing anything and everything to make sure it's right. First one's awareness. The second one is acceptance. Because once he's made us aware of our need of him, then he can accept me. That goes to Luke with Zacchaeus. Jesus accepted Zacchaeus for who he was. He was the bottom of the barrel. He was the scoundrel of scoundrels. He was the most marginalized and hated individual in his society. And yet Jesus says, you know what, Zacchaeus? I'm coming to your house. Because salvation has come to your house. It's a word about how God accepts us right where we are. Oh, I need somebody to hear me today. I know there's some church folk that won't accept you. I know you got some family members that won't accept you. I know there's some folk in the community that doesn't accept you. But aren't you glad Jesus is not like any of those individuals? He accepts you where you are as you are. But watch this. I'm going to say it like my mentor, Bishop Omar. He loves you enough to accept you right where you are, but he loves you too much to leave you. Which leads to my third one, and I'm almost finished, and that's dedication. And that's what we see with Mary. How do we experience change? It's the next level of dedication. And dedication only happens with some kind of sacrifice. And that's what Mary is trying to show us. How does God move her to the next level of dedication? She makes the supreme sacrifice because she loves her Savior. She takes a bottle of perfume that costs about what the average person makes in a year. The question is, what is she saving it up for? She's saving the perfume for her wedding night. She got plans for her man. Am I talking to my church or this another crowd? I'm trying to. But when you meet the man, she went and grabbed that bottle and she broke that bottle because you don't know what Jesus has done for me. He's taken my dedication to a whole new level. And so my last point very quickly, let Jesus lead you. And here's where I'm trying to land this thing. And so Jesus comes to Jerusalem, and you see a glimpse of this in Matthew. You also see a glimpse of it in Mark. But in 42, he says, if you had even had only known on this day what would bring peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. It's that moment where Jesus weeps over the city because he reached out and tried to bring Israel to himself. And what did they do? They turned away from him. They rejected him. And the rejection was seen in the crucifixion. He tried to gather him. Matthew says, I tried to gather you like a hen gathers his chicks, but you kept me from doing it. And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but somebody has come to church today. That's what Palm Sunday is about. That's what the resurrection is. Whether you're saved or you don't know him, he's trying to gather you onto himself. And I know what you're saying. You say, well, Pastor, you don't know the things I've done. You don't know my background. I've struggled with some things mightily. I don't know if Jesus can fix anything in your life. I'm here to tell you, he can fix it. I wish I had about four or five that can testify. He can fix a broken heart. He can fix shame. He can fix sin. He can fix addiction. He can fix a broke life. He can fix a broke body. He can fix a broke mind. He can fix a broken identity. Is there anybody in here knows that Jesus can fix it? I was a kid in the church. They used to sing a song, Jesus will fix it. I didn't know what they were talking about. I had broken toys as a little boy. I thought maybe he can fix my toys. But as I got older, I've been through some stuff. I've had my heart broken. I've broken some hearts. I've made some mistakes. And then the Lord took me back to that song that Jesus will fix it. That's my word to somebody today. I don't care what you've been through. Palm Sunday is a reminder that Jesus can fix it. He can fix it. He'll fix your sins. He'll fix your loneliness. He'll fix your grief. He'll fix your tears that fall in the midnight. He'll fix misunderstanding. He'll fix your enemies. Is there anybody that knows the Lord will fix it? Hey! Hey! He'll fix it. He'll fix it. Well, how does he fix it, Pastor? All right, I got to tell you how he fix it. Then we're going to do the Lord's Supper. He'll fix it. Lord gave this one to me this week. He'll fix it. And so I'm washing my dishes after I cook. Tell your neighbor, strong men cook. Because y'all looking at me strange. And my wife cooked too now. Hold up now. But strong men cook too. And I wish I had a witness from the brother. Strong men wash their own dishes too. Now I can finish my story. As this strong black man was washing his dishes, I had cooked me a really good meal and I was kind of proud of myself. And so I went and sat on the couch a little longer than I normally do. I normally wash my dishes immediately. My wife will tell you I'm on top of it immediately. And I let the dish sit. And you know with gravy, it's going to stick to that plate. And so when I came to wash the dishes, of course I tried to wipe them. And I couldn't get the gravy out. And then, of course, you know, you got the dishwasher and they got these pellets that you can just put it in as is. I tried that before. Tell your neighbor, that don't work. That don't work. It's a lie. It's a lie. You better scrub it before you put it in that dishwasher. So I wasn't going to do that. And so what I've done in the past, sometimes I'll get if it's really caked on there, I'll take a knife and try to get it off and cake, you know, kind of cut it off, you know, scrape it off. Why y'all looking at me like you don't know what I'm talking about? So I'm gonna scrape it off. The problem is, if you scrape it off, you gonna damage a good dish. And all the women, y'all more sensitive about the plate than you are about your man. So I knew what I had to do. And this is when the Lord starts speaking. He said, just let it soak in the water. And watch what the Lord said. As it soaks in the presence of the water. The presence of the water absorbs what was caked into the dish. So that when you pull it out later, it's nice and clean. See, I know some folk here today, you tired of that surface Christianity where you just wipe it off. Because that doesn't get to the stain. And nobody wants legalism, because all you do with legalism, all you're going to do is damage the people in the process. But I'm talking about an anointing that comes from on high. If you just wait in his presence just a little while, he'll wash the stain away. Jesus can fix it. Have I got a witness in here today? Come on, get your cup. Just soak in his presence. And that's how you get the stain out. That's how you get over the addiction. My good friend, the late McKinley Haley, he had his own struggles. He said, Doc, I had to worship my way through it. Because everywhere I went couldn't get me through it. Am I right, Travis? I had to worship my way through it. And I didn't understand it. He said, the anointing delivered me. And I'm not saying there are not other sources that can help you that God has gifted. But I ain't trading it for the anointing. I'm not trading it for the power of God. Jesus can fix it. Ah, what are you saying, Pastor? Here's all I'm asking. It's in your notes. Let's engage Passion Week. Time of confession, time of prayer, time of soaking in God's presence. Let's put down our devices. In your notes today, the scriptures for each day are there. Let's read them. Let's meditate on them. You got the 14 stations online that's going to drop, I think, tonight or tomorrow morning. And then let's meet here for corporate prayer. There's a tremendous service. I promise you, it'll change your life that is being prepared for Wednesday, that we can put some stuff down forever because of the cross. Join us here Wednesday night, 7 p.m. for corporate prayer. Let's do Passion Week together. That's all I'm asking. That's what Palm Sunday's about. We have a pure, peaceable, impartial faith. Let's stay with that and watch God bless us. Let us bow for a moment and let the Lord speak to your heart where you are. How is God speaking to you today? That's all. The Lord is in this place, y'all. He loves you. He loves you. Will you trust him today? Trust him by faith. Let the Lord lead you. That's all. It's an unusual victory parade, but you'll get the victory. You'll get it. Father, we're soaking in your presence right now. This incredible worship we've experienced this morning. I already feel a little bit cleansed, even before I started preaching, Lord. And I thank you for that. I thank you for this amazing worship experience. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the power of the gospel. And Lord, for this Passion Week in which we celebrate all that you did, that knowing on the western wall a cross awaited you, you still went into Jerusalem. We say thanks. Thank you, Lord. We trust you. Meet each of us today, this week, as we reflect, confess, reconcile, repent and trust, praise and worship, all of it, Lord. May it have a life-changing experience for all of us, that we may truly celebrate Resurrection Sunday with your power and passion. In Jesus' name, and everybody say it, amen, amen, amen. Lord's Supper is very important, church. It's a word about God's presence with us, but also it's a word about how God loves us all. There's no big I's or little U's at the Lord's table. Hierarchy was a big deal in that culture. The wealthy ate first, and the lower class ate last at the banquets. And the Lord gives us the Lord's Supper and says, there's nothing but level ground at the cross. Let us eat together. Juice, a symbol of his blood that was shed for us, we have the forgiveness of sins.